The strategy of contextualizing white supremacist icons within existing and expanding structures of university administration and policing might be best understood as a particularly insidious torsion of the rhetoric of diversity and inclusion through the process of staging difference. The performance of racial inclusiveness for the sake of institutional impression management, rather than for producing a racially equitable campus. End quote. UIN professor of geography Danielle Purifoy identifies this dynamic in her reflection on Silent Sam's removal, connecting the overt violence of Silent Sam's neo-Confederate supporters with the smiling violence of many mostly white administrators and faculty at white schools across this country, who place an economic and social chokehold on the parameters of our political and intellectual existence on campus as they titillate themselves publicly with proclamations of diversity and inclusion. End quote. In the case of Silent Sam, contextualization posits white supremacy as an idea among others, reassimilating white supremacy into the structure of the university under the guises of historical objectivity and the requirement of tolerance for a diversity of ideas. The dual impulse to historically contextualize and violently police reveals clear fault lines within the operating logic of university diversity regimes. On the one hand, contextualization promises to proliferate knowledge about slavery and the rise of Jim Crow, apparently for anti-racist ends, disavowal of similarity with these earlier eras. On the other, the expansion of permissible ideas within the institutional discourses of the university, in the form of the acknowledgement of violence in the university's past, necessitates a consolidation of power around the edges of that information, in the form of the normalization of violence in the university's present. The material investments in policing attached to UNC's initial plans for contextualization starkly reveal that while violence characterizes exclusion from the universality of the human, it also accompanies inclusion or assimilation into it. End quote. Permissible knowledge about the reality of white supremacy in the past cannot be transformed into impermissible action directed against white supremacy in its institutional forms in the present. The university arrests the students whose labor and presence on campus serve as the justification of the university's existence in a diverse society. As white supremacy concedes ground on certain symbolic fronts, it entrenches along others, and so as Adam H. Dombey puts it, fact-checking is not enough when addressing lies that undermine democracy. End quote. Against the assumption of historical difference between a racist past and a diverse present that underwrites contextualization as an administrative attempt to accommodate white supremacy within the governing paradigm of diversity and inclusion, we must understand any form of preservation of Confederate monuments as active perpetuation of white supremacy and anti-blackness in institutional spaces. To wrestle with the lingering implications of Carr's dedication, then, requires interrogating how institutions like universities perpetuate white supremacy through inaction, compromise, and equivocation. Carr's speech depicts an act of domination over not only his unnamed victim, but also, and perhaps more importantly, for the political logic of the lost cause, over federal authority represented as an occupying military force. In a rehearsal of the failures of Reconstruction in microcosm, Carr's acts of violence are met with inaction. Carr challenges the authority of the federal government through public acts of anti-black violence, but it is the federal troops' lack of response that provides the real evidence of Carr's white power. As Reconstruction wore on and wore down, white apathy and hostility in the rest of the country would become one of the largest obstacles for black Southerners in their fight for legal and social inclusion. Responding to Carr's legacy requires interrogating the role passivity disavowal and institutional inertia have played in fostering white supremacy in the United States, so we can better imagine ways to build new institutions in which meaningful anti-racist transformation might become possible. If Carr's celebration of the permissibility of racist violence speaks across the century to our own time, the novels of his contemporary Albion W. Tourget offer one way we might begin to consider compromise and half-measures, especially those undertaken in the name of preserving abstract notions of social order that already works for everyone, as important tools for the expansion of white supremacy. Tourget captures the turmoil of Reconstruction and its abandonment by the federal government in his best-selling novel, A Fool's Errand, 1879. an important if largely forgotten piece of 19th century American literary and political history. A white Ohio-born lawyer, judge, politician, and author who lived in Greensboro from 1865 to 1880, Tourjée moved to North Carolina hoping to transform the South by putting into practice the ideals of individual liberty, free labor, and equality before the law. Tourjée left North Carolina having nearly destroyed his marriage and finances in a losing battle to keep control of the state government out of the hands of ex-Confederate politicians. Originally published anonymously in November 1879, A Fool's Errand appeared in an expanded second edition in 1880 bearing Tourjée's name and accompanied by a 12-chapter appendix entitled The Invisible Empire, which provided documentation for Tourjée's influential and controversial account of the Ku Klux Klan in the novel. Centered on the failed Reconstruction career of Comfort Servaus, a loosely fictionalized version of Tourjée himself, A Fool's Errand explores how ideals of equality and justice alone failed to interrupt the reemergence of white supremacy in North Carolina after the Civil War. Describing his optimism in this era later in life, Tourjée would write, "I believed in many things then. I believed in the United States as the flower of liberty, security, and equal right for all. I believed the abolition of slavery was all that was required to establish ultimate equality for and in right, opportunity, and security before the law." End quote. As he reflects in A Fool's Errand, such formal changes did not address the material reality of white supremacy. Slavery as a formal state of society was at an end. As a force, a power, a moral element, it was just as active as before as a form of society. It could be abolished by proclamation and enactment. As a moral entity, it is as indestructible as the souls on which it has left its mark. End quote. Beyond revealing acts of violence from the antebellum and Reconstruction eras that help us challenge major facets of Lost Cause mythology, Tourjée's novel interrogates how white supremacists made sense of the violence they committed, and most importantly, how they turned the language and logic of post-emancipation politics into tools for the reconsolidation of power. A Fool's Errand, therefore, offers a lesson in dynamics of institutional and interpersonal politics through which extralegal violence and lost cause historical memory work together to build institutions whose white supremacy consisted not only in the beliefs of its members, but in the very structures and logics through which institutional action and inaction could be defined. In the remainder of this chapter, I situate A Fool's Errand in its early Jim Crow era historical context, outline some of the ways that Tourjée's political vision offers insight into 21st century conversations about racism and institutional power, and then finally offer readings of scenes from A Fool's Errand in which Tourjée dramatizes the interplay between fabricated historical memory and the normalization of white supremacy within Reconstruction era political institutions. Situating Tourjée's novel historically is complicated by the fact that so much of the literary life of Lost Cause mythology emerged as a response to the success of works like A Fool's Errand. As Carolyn L. Karcher writes in the afterword to her 2016 study of Tourjée's post-Reconstruction writing career, the process of rescuing Tourjée from the oblivion to which the triumph of white supremacy consigned him in his lifetime has been long, bumpy, and arduous. End quote. The novel's runaway success in 1879 to 1880 helped raise awareness about the increasing disenfranchisement and economic re-enslavement of black citizens in the South among northern voters. A Fool's Errand galvanized Republican voters, who rallied behind James Garfield in the 1880 presidential election, momentarily recommitting the federal government to the defense of the economic and political freedom of freedmen and women in the South. Tragically, Garfield was assassinated less than a year into his first term, and his vice president, Chester A. Arthur, proved uninterested in interfering in Southern politics. For a second time, Tourjée's grand hopes for racial equality in the country were squashed. The rise of Jim Crow wiped away many of the new political protections for black North Carolinians that Tourjée had championed. As his political program withered away under Jim Crow rule, Tourjée's literary legacy was also subject to white supremacist attacks. Writing in the aftermath of the initial defeat of Reconstruction governance in North Carolina, Tourjée used fictional narratives to expose the relationship among organized clandestine white supremacist violence, the historical memory used to justify it, and the constitutionally illegitimate operation of state institutions like courts and legislatures then in the hands of former Confederates. In the early 20th century, literature and film celebrated the apparent virtues of white supremacist political rule that Tourjée spent his adult life fighting against. North Carolinian Thomas Dixon's novels The Leopard Spots, 1902, and The Klansman, 1905, were literary responses to Tourjée's novels and politics, and their success helped close the book on Tourjée's public reputation. When they were adapted by D.W. Griffith into The Birth of a Nation, 1915, these narratives birthed both modern cinema and the modern Ku Klux Klan. The massive popular success of Lost Cause narratives among white audiences found academic support among white historians whose early 20th century output consistently presented slavery as a largely peaceful and harmonious social system and Reconstruction as a period of Northern and Black-led destruction of civil society in the South. While his racist contemporaries like Thomas Nelson Page and Dixon promoted Lost Cause mythology by writing novels that imputed heroism to ex-Confederates and Klansmen to imply different views of what the postbellum South should strive for, through views of the future that are narratively linked to the past, end quote. Tourjée exposes how such violence and the questionable historical memory that justified it delayed and diminished transformation in the material, political, and social status of newly recognized black citizens. While Tourjée stages scenes wherein his protagonist resists and counters incipient Lost Cause mythmaking and other smaller-scale narratives of white Southern virtue and innocence, A Fool's Errand is provocatively pessimistic about the efficacy of mere debunking and insists on the necessity of building and sustaining power to foster and defend racial equity. Arriving before the explosion of Lost Cause mythology in the final years of the 19th century, Tourjée's novel helps us read Confederate monuments within their institutional contexts by doing more than simply naming white supremacist violence and offering a historically accurate counter-narrative to the Lost Cause. Instead, Tourjée illustrates how this violence was, in essence, put into institutional context by its practitioners, interpreted within the language and logic of free labor and local sovereignty that allowed racial exploitation and violence to continue unabated. In the final years of his life, as Dixon's star rose alongside the entrenchment of his narrative of Reconstruction, Tourjée remained an unapologetic defender of Reconstruction's founding promises and staunch in his appraisal of its failure. When a former classmate suggested that The Leopard Spots and A Fool's Errand were on the same footing as equally biased, but equally valid, representatives of opposing viewpoints, Tourjée responded in frustration that Dixon's novels were useless as historiography, but valuable for their insight into the mind of Jim Crow-era white elites. Tourjée balked at the suggestion that his and Dixon's novels were equally accurate because equally biased. Accounts of Reconstruction, going so far as to point out that for men like Dixon, the pretense of historical accuracy meant nothing outside of its rhetorical usefulness in maintaining power. He is right. Tourjée wrote sarcastically of the air of historical authority put on by Dixon and other Lost Cause mythmakers, indubitably right, not because he has studied a matter, but because he cannot be wrong. End quote. Tourjée highlights that what is really at stake in Dixon's work is an exercise of racial authority. His novels are monuments to white supremacy's power to produce and maintain its own truths. We can read A Fool's Errand as an object lesson in the peril of such moral and epistemological equivocation that continues to structure disparate university responses to racist violence and symbols and anti-racist community defense. Tourjée provides a challenge to the idea that correct knowledge and moral beliefs lead to just outcomes through the animating concept of foolishness. Distinct from ignorance, which suggests a lack of knowledge, foolishness suggests both a naive idealism and a credulity about the intentions of political adversaries that leave the subject vulnerable to manipulation and exploitation. This credulity is a central feature of Tourjée's political thinking in A Fool's Errand. Tourjée refers to Servaas as the fool throughout the novel. At the novel's climax, after the Klan has been disbanded in North Carolina, without its members facing consequences for their violent lawlessness, Servaas wonders at the seeming lack of contradiction between such extreme terror and the patterns of everyday life. Were they deliberately savage and vicious? End quote. Servaus asks himself, or was he in error? End quote. This is a moment of crisis for Servaus's liberal ideals and his belief that an interest in human equality and justice is universal. Was there any absolute standard of right? End quote. He continues, or were religion and morality merely relative and incidental terms? Was that right in Georgia, which was wrong in Maine? End quote. Tourget's rhetorical questions imply a negative response, thereby galvanizing readerly support for the reinvigoration of federal intervention in the southern states. Yet a recognition of facts on the ground was not enough to be transformative. Tourget sought real changes to the way federal and state governments interacted in order to use the force of the federal government to combat white supremacist violence and fraud happening at the state level. The flawed idealism of Tourget's 19th century fool anticipates limitations in the 20th century liberal ideal of colorblindness, a transcendent goal of equality before the law, regardless of race. End quote. We can understand university diversity regimes as embodying colorblind frameworks within academic, administrative, and promotional contexts. In the 20th century, the ascendance of racial liberalism professing the same ideals as Tourget, equality before the law and individual sovereignty within the market, would transform black political demands into partial reforms of existing institutions without fully addressing core economic and legal disparities that produce and maintain racial hierarchies within the United States. The apparent success of mid-century civil rights reforms produces in our own time a sense of white self-satisfaction and colorblind racism that relegates racial violence to the past without addressing its lingering manifestations. As Charles Mills frames this colorblind logic in the field of political theory, in a perfectly just society, race would not exist, so we do not have to concern ourselves with matters of racial justice in our own society. End quote. Tourget addressed analogous concerns in his own time, writing in 1888 that readers in the United States esteem slavery as simply a dead, unpleasant fact of which they wish to hear no more, and regard any disparaging allusion to its results as an attempt to revive a defunct political sentiment.